Isaac Asimov, the famous science fiction writer, has written a short story called Strike Breaker. In this short story, it is about a future planet in which certain works are considered as defiled. People who indulge in those works are considered as untouchables. And then these untouchable people start a strike. A person who enters that particular planet, looking at the entire society suffering because of the strike, he goes and he operates a particular instrument that only the untouchables operate. So the strike is broken, and then he thinks that the people in the planet would be very thankful to him, but the people say, now that you have touched that particular instrument and operated it, you too have become an untouchable, so you have to leave the planet. Then he writes this. It is included in a compilation which teaches sociology and anthropology through science fiction, this particular short story. And in this, Asimov gives an explanation which is very important. He says that the caste structures spontaneously arises in almost all the societies. They become rigid when the society loses its resources and mobility. When the society loses its resources and mobility, then the caste structures become rigid. Phenomenon like untouchability evolve. You want to restrict the access to the resources as much as possible with your own people, and you want to exclude as much as possible other people. So this happens in every society. When there is increase in capital and when there is increase in mobility, then there is no need to maintain the caste system. So in Europe, in the West, the caste system, remember, this caste system was actually 7-layered, not 4-layered. In India, the varnas, chaturvarna, there are 4 varnas. Whereas in the case of Europe, they have 7 layers, as we all know, with the dukes and the princes and the bishops and the counts and the aristocrats, then the serfs and the peasants. You have this 7-layered structure. And they justified this 7-layered pyramid by telling that there are 7 layers to the heaven. And the 7 layers in the society actually reflect the 7 layers of the heaven. It is a heaven-ordained system. It has to be maintained. The hierarchy has to be maintained. So they justified this through religion, maintained it. Even today, if you look at the European model, you will find that it is a pyramid. It is always the pyramid. The more it accomplishes, more the pyramid becomes magnificent, larger the social base becomes. The people in the base have to increase. If you look at the monumental successes, the technological achievements of Europe, and say we haven't achieved it, you always forget to look at the base. You have the African mines. You have the coal mines in Bihar. You have the indentured labors of Indians suffering in all parts of the planet. They would be supporting the greatest achievements of Europe. But you will only be looking at the achievements of Europe. You will never look at the base of the pyramid. In the case of India, that is not the one. So the point that again we want to come to is, you had in Europe a pyramidal structure with the social hierarchy, with the social discrimination, with the social exclusion and social prejudice. But what is absent in Europe is any literature from religion that criticizes and condemns this. In the case of India, you have a torrential flow of spiritual literature from the Vedic literature. Remember the story of Kavachana. From the Vedic literature, to the literature of Kabir and Nanak, to the literature of Dayanmars and Alvars, condemning the social exclusion and social prejudice, criticizing the tendencies towards social stagnation. But in the case of Europe, it is conspicuous by its absence. But Europe was able to shed its caste structure by importing it into racial discriminations and indentured labors and colonialism throughout the world. It just distributed its misery to the entire world and made itself look like utopian. Even now it is not utopian, even now there is no egalitarianism. Despite that, it made to look itself as if it is egalitarian, and then it started passing prejudicial judgments over the other cultures, like the Indian culture. And then we get those frameworks, we apply those frameworks to our own epics, and then we tell that, yeah, yes, we are all very cruel, we are inhuman, and we've discriminated against our people in a very bad way. And the Europeans came and gave us enlightenment. The point is, did we discriminate against our own people? We did. We have been victims, yes, true. But were we the only people who did this? No. In a way, our own caste structures became rigid, our own caste structures developed inhuman tendencies more during the colonization, during the invasions. We were a society under siege for over 700 years and 800 years. We have been fighting against. And in this, our social structures naturally amplified some of its negative tendencies. Nevertheless, we have been fighting against colonization. At the same time, we have also been fighting against such social discriminations. And what great examples we have. And all those examples didn't come from English education. One example, one particular important example is that of Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. When, as Kathadhara, he enters the temple, he first thinks that, oh, I am entering the temple that has been built by a Sudra woman, and now I have to eat as prasad whatever this woman is providing to the temple. So he had this natural prejudice. The gospel of Sri Ramakrishna, as well as the Kadamrata, it chronicles the whole thing. The life of Sri Ramakrishna, the master, chronicles it. Then, as he progresses through this spiritual sadhana, what he does? He sheds all these prejudices, and to make sure that his mind is filled with the feeling of being a servant of all, he goes to the toilet of the so-called untouchable. He uses his own head to carry the night soil of that particular untouchable person, so that the completely caste prejudice would be removed from him. And this is the sadhana of the person whom the Indian culture considers as Yugavada. He didn't get this feeling of equality and the sense of sadhana that would remove his caste prejudices. You see, now the westernized so-called Dalit literature, people write about why don't you clean your own toilet with your own hands, and those kind of very crude, angry poetry is being written. But long before all this came into being, Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa did it as a sadhana, and he was not educated in any English schools. His sense of social justice came from his spiritual sadhana. And through this spiritual sadhana, he gave us a framework how to remove our own sins of social discrimination. If a person like Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa had to remove the night soil of a scheduled community person with his own head, so that the feeling of social prejudice and social exclusion be removed from his mind, what kind of sadhana that we people like us have to undertake to remove those kind of social exclusion from our social prejudices from our own mind? Remember, ultimately the social exclusion, social stagnation are diseases of the mind. They have to be removed in the inner space. And for that, Indian spirituality provides the best tools. If we are not able to use it, at least we should not condemn it. And the West has taught us to condemn it. Think about this. Kagors were there. They were part of the social dynamics. The untouchability was there. Social exclusion was there. Take the entire Das Kapital. Do you find a single mention of it? Marx, Karl Marx, who was supposed to provide liberation for humanity at large, he had talked nothing about the actual social exclusion that was prevalent throughout Europe. He was silent about it. In fact, he justifies even slavery as a necessary evil. That is another thing. He himself was a racist. That is another thing. He first accepted Darwin's evolution and then rejected Darwin's evolution and accepted a more racial concept of evolution. That is another thing. We don't get into all that. But what we are asking is, if Marxism is such a great thing, if Marx was really moved by the plight of the people, if his heart was actually beating for the entire humanity, where is that one line in which he talks against social exclusion that was prevalent in Europe? Is absent. The point is, the Indian cultural savants, they score better in terms of the feeling, the empathy for fellow human beings than any of the European progressives. Remember this. In fact, next we will be seeing the different Indian savants, Indian seers, who fought against social discrimination through Indic framework and how the Western civilization almost did nothing to create such seers in India. In India, the fight for social justice always been done by Indian seers, Indian savants, not by the Western educated radicals. The Western educated radicals, they at best, what they did was, they demonized Indian culture. They derived a kind of a perverse pleasure in demonizing Indian culture. To them, the social problems, the social injustice was a capital to demonize Indian culture. Whereas for the Indian savants, the innate strengths of India were used to fight against any social stagnation, any social exclusion, and to fight for social justice, and along with social justice also social harmony. This is the difference between the Western educated people and the Indians. The reason is that in West, the social exclusion and social injustice was not eradicated but was transferred to other people. In India, we do not seek to do that. We choose to destroy the social injustice not by transferring it to some other people but by creating a greater global harmony. That is the difference between the Indic move towards social justice and the illusion of social justice that exists in the West.